So I'm going to be talking about GraphQL today, and in particular the Angular implementation of GraphQL. Just to briefly describe who I am, as Bill mentioned, I'm a principal engineer at Charter. I work for the Core Backbone Operations Group, and just clarify, it's not Backbone the framework, it's actually the router backbone network. Right now I'd say actually just started this position last Friday, where I am basically in charge of selecting, developing, and architecting, configuring tools for that group. I am a sysadmin turned web application developer. I was a Unix sysadmin for a number of years. I ended up actually starting my own company when I lived in Austin. We manage internet service for apartment complexes. And that's where I first got into more full stack development. I am a recent transplant to Denver from Austin. I moved up here last year, and I'm enjoying the, as I'm told, a mild winter, but I am ready for it to be over anytime now. Oops. And I also have play billiards in a pool league, which I've done since around 2001. And my family enjoys playing Euro-style board games. You can see my LinkedIn, email, and GitHub right there, and some of the technologies that I work with, both professionally and for personal projects. I started off in AngularJS a few years ago and switched to Angular 2 last year, where I was been working on one main project for Charter. I also did some Ionic with my last company, and just started kind of picking up the newest version, making an app currently this year. Use NGRX, obviously GraphQL, do a little bit of Firebase and a little bit of Node, but mostly I focus on front-end development. What are we going to talk about today? Angular and GraphQL. We're going to talk about what is GraphQL. Some GraphQL implementations on both the front-end and back-end. And then if we have time at the end, we'll do a little GraphQL versus REST comparison. If you have any questions that can't wait, feel free to interrupt. But otherwise, I guess we'll have some time at the end, hopefully. So what is GraphQL? It is a query language for APIs and a runtime for fulfilling those queries with your existing data. It is a response to modern web application needs. Some people describe it as a replacement for REST, but I think it's more of a, I would describe it more of as an alternative to REST. It was developed internally by Facebook in 2012 and then released publicly in 2015. And unlike REST, as we'll get to later, it has an actual specification. Since it's not just a philosophy, there is an actual spec to go along with it. Is anyone here currently using GraphQL for anything? Okay. These are some of the companies that are using GraphQL that I grabbed from the GraphQL page, some of the ones that I recognized, obviously Facebook, but there's a lot of bigger names in there. I think Spotify is a pretty big GraphQL API, public API available. I don't know specifically how all of these companies are implementing it or using it. But hopefully you, as soon as this demonstration is over, you can add to the list. Just to give you an idea of GraphQL popularity, you can compare it to REST. A lot of people have heard of it and would like to use it. Not so many people are using it yet. Obviously, compared to REST, a much more mature, even if it's not a specific implementation, it's been around a lot longer and it's pretty ubiquitous. But you can also compare it to, if you're familiar with, I believe, Falcor, Netflix, another implementation of data querying. Did not seem to catch on very well, but GraphQL looks like it's going to be gaining a lot of popularity in the coming future. So why did Facebook create GraphQL? So back around 2012, when they were making the move from HTML5 to native, they were encountering some problems using REST. Probably some or even the majority of them may have been specific to their implementation of REST. As you know, you can have multiple ways of implementing a REST API. They needed a data fetching API that was powerful enough to describe all of Facebook, yet simple enough to be easy to learn and use by product developers. So they came up with GraphQL, which is hierarchical in nature. As you know, if you use REST, oftentimes multiple round trips are incurred trying to fetch different data from different endpoints. Whereas in GraphQL, since we don't think of data in terms of resource URLs and secondary keys and join tables, we think about it more in terms of a graph of objects and the models that we ultimately use in our apps, and that's kind of reflected in the way that GraphQL queries data. So each level of GraphQL query corresponds to a particular type, and each type describes a set of available fields, similar to SQL, and that allows GraphQL to provide descriptive error messages before executing a query. You'll also note that with REST, the client depends on the server, and that can incur some breaking changes. If you have to change your backend, then you've got to make sure all your front end is either up to date or will not be broken by those changes. A GraphQL server can be queried for the types that it supports, and it is strongly typed, and that's what that introspection is referring to. So you can actually ask a GraphQL server, what does your API look like? And it'll tell you, and you can that creates a powerful platform for tools and client software to build atop that information, like code generation in statically typed languages, frameworks, and IDEs. They can all use that information to help you when you're coding. And that introspection also allows you to build. GraphQL APIs usually come with called Graphical. And that'll help you build and learn and explore your API quickly without having to resorting to things like curl to even determine what your API does and how it works. So let's talk a little bit about GraphQL software. I'm going to start off by talking about back-end software. Is anyone here do front-end and back-end, or are you mostly front-end? I got some nods, all right. So as far as back-end servers, from the JavaScript arena, there is what's called Apollo GraphQL, and that's a node middleware library for Express, Happy, Koa, and various other frameworks. There's also a few GraphQL backend as a service providers. GraphQL, I believe, is the most popular. There's one called Scaffold. Hasura is they've been around for a while, but I think they just recently started supporting GraphQL. PostgraphQL is the one that I tend to use most often, and we'll talk a bit more about that in just a bit. There are other implementations in a wide variety of languages if you don't want to write a JavaScript backend as well. You can choose any modern language pretty much to create a GraphQL backend. This is a basic GraphQL schema. You can see you've got authors and posts. It looks very similar to what you would see maybe a TypeScript class or interface. So authors and posts have IDs that are integers. The exclamation point means that they're required. Then you have a few string fields. And if you notice an author, it has an array of posts. And then post is structured similarly. And then the schema allows for queries, such as looking up, can't see it on my laptop, I can't see it over here. You can look up posts for specific authors, and then mutations. So GraphQL, as opposed to REST, is divided up into just two basic areas. You don't have your, as far as CRUD is concerned, you've got your reads are queries, and everything else is a mutation. So your creates, updates, and deletes are all mutations. The PostgraphQL API server I stumbled upon when I was looking to build my first backend. I realized, well, I've already got, I tend to use Postgres for my data source, data store, and I realized, well, I've already got a Postgres schema. Why should I have to create a very similar schema for an API? And that's where PostgraphQL comes in. It's going to connect to your Postgres server and generate an API based on that schema. It's formerly known as PostgraphQL. They changed the name when they went to version 4. It's a completely re-architected version. It is still currently in beta, but I've been using it for a while. It's pretty stable. It can be used as a standalone or as a Node.js middleware library. I've also used it inside of Nest.js, if you've ever used that. It does have its own internal JSON web token handling. If you're using that for your authorization, it'll both generate and parse the tokens in order to determine, you know, which tables and it's allowed to query and update. The big thing that they added with the move from PostgraphQL to PostgraphQL is that it's now extensible with plugins. There's a pretty popular one that's a filter plugin that allows you to do some more complex queries, and we'll look at that a little bit when we do a good demo. And you can also create stored procedures, Postgraph functions, in your database, and it will recognize those, and you can call those with your API as well if you need to perform some more complex business logic other than what the API gives you. So for example, let's say you build a schema like this within Postgres. You've got, similar to what we saw before, an author in a post table, you've got your IDs, first, last name are strings, and then your post with a title and a number of votes, and then a foreign key relationship there, so every post has an author. And just by connecting to your database, PostgraphQL, you just run it there as a standalone server. It'll give you what port it's listening on, tell you what it's connecting to, default schema is public, and it'll give you an API on that GraphQL endpoint, and then that graphical thing that we'll look at in a little bit is an API Explorer. And as soon as it connects, it'll generate this whole API for you. So you've got your queries and mutations based on the authors and the author and the post tables. You're going to get an all authors query. You can query a specific author by whatever field. And then you'll notice there's some by author IDs and by post ID queries and mutations, and those are generated based on unique fields within the database. So since those are primary key, those are automatically unique. So any unique field or fields that you have in the database, if you have, for example, first name, last name are both unique for whatever reason in your table, you'll be able to query authors by first name and last name. And then on the right side there, your mutations, create, update, and delete for everything, and then add to that additional by author or by post ID. So I went from using Swaggerize and SQLize in terms of a Node.js backend, having an incomplete backend, having to create a new endpoint every time I wanted to do something. And Swaggerize and SQLize help. They do a lot of boilerplate for you, but I went from a very incomplete backend to a complete backend just by switching to PostgraphQL in about a week, which was really nice. Let's now switch to the front end, because I know that's what most of us here are here for, since we're talking about Angular. There are client implementations in basically all the same languages as the backend servers. Probably the most popular one is Apollo, and Apollo has a specific implementation for Angular, which is very similar to any of the other Apollo implementations. It is created by the Meteor Development Group, and it works with Apollo in general works with Angular, React, Vue, Android, iOS, Ember, and Meteor. And there's the URL for the Angular specific version there. So to get started in an Angular application, these are the packages you would add. Apollo Angular, Angular Link HTTP. Apollo supports caching, so you can add a cache module there, and it'll cache your data for you, and we'll go over that in a little bit. And then the GraphQL tag in GraphQL is for generating your queries and mutations. So let's actually see some Angular here. All right, so here is the Angular module. Imports the Apollo libraries, and then you create a client down here with the Apollo link from method. And I added an HTTP link and an error link to it. So the HTTP link is brought up from my environment URL, which just goes to localhost. And then the error link is just a kind of a generic error thing I added in order to catch network errors and display a global alert. And that global alert isn't part of anything, it's just something I added. So when you create your client, then you can use that in a service or provider to interface with your API. You can also add, if you're using the JavaScript web tokens, you can add an auth link in that module, and you would include it within that Apollo link, in that Apollo link from. Same way, so what this does, if you're storing your token in local storage, you can grab it, create your authorization header, and then anytime you access your API over that client, it's going to add that header to your request. So to make a request, you use a GraphQL string. Notice that this is a query. Notice that it looks kind of like an object, but when you're creating it, it is actually just a string. So the different parts of it, you've got your operation name. You've got denoting whether it's a query or a mutation. You can use variables in here, which we'll cover in just a minute, and then you look at all your fields that you can grab. So say you have a user table and then you have an address table. You can see right here that you can nest your query so you can get your user and automatically include an address that may be associated with that user in one request. You don't have to make those multiple round trips that we were talking about earlier. Recording. So this is the same string, and if you look at it here, here's the response that comes back, and the first thing you notice is that it looks pretty much exactly like your request. So you're saying, I want to request this user, and it's going to come back and say, okay, here's this user and exactly what you requested. These are the fields you wanted. Okay, I'm going to give them back to you. If there were 10 other fields associated with the user, you could request those as well. You don't have to write different endpoints to get each of those combinations of fields. And again, you can also ask for that address that's associated with that user, and it'll come back and give that to you in one request. Now, say you don't want to, you're going to be reusing that address in different places throughout your application. You can also use what GraphQL refers to as fragments, just to kind of reuse different portions of queries and mutations. So, for example, here we've got a fragment address fragment on the address object has these four fields, and then every time you want to use that specific fragment, you just use a little spread operator in your string, and it will include that data the same as it would in the previous query. So when we're creating our API service in Angular, we can add, and this is just the query that I'm using in mind. You can obviously come up with your own that does more or less things. These are just a few of the options that I'm using with Apollo. So the query string is what we just looked at. You can add variables to look up a specific, say you want a specific ID, and you don't just want ID number one all the time, obviously. You can pass those into your queries. And then fetch policies, as I mentioned earlier, Apollo will cache your requests and the responses to them, so you can tell it how to handle your cache, and we'll go over some more of those details in just a little bit. You'll notice that the queries are of type query ref. They don't return observables. So a query ref is very similar to an observable, it just adds a few extra methods to make it for convenience, and that's mostly to go along with Apollo Server, but you can use it with any backend. So that is what's returned by this watch query method on your Apollo client, and just passing in basically the same thing we gave to the server, and then you see an error policy there that we'll go over in just a minute as well. So a query ref gives you all of these additional things that you can do. If you just want the observable, you just use value changes method on it, and that'll return the results of your query. A few other notable ones, it does support subscriptions, so you can use it with real-time data. PostGraphile does not support subscriptions yet, but that is on its roadmap somewhere. You can support polling. So say you want to run a query every minute, you can add that option in there as well. So it's a lot of a nice features in that query ref. It does also return the loading state. So when you subscribe to a watch query, that query ref, you can tell when it's done loading because it'll include it. Just a Boolean indicating if the query is in flight. It will emit once that query is complete, and it'll be set to false unless you use one of those parameters that we didn't include in our query. But you can, it's very configurable to do what you want it to do. The fetch policies, so it's got four different policies. The default one is cache first. That's going to basically say if you've got the data in your cache, it's going to return it from your cache. And then if it's not available, it'll check the network. And then it's got the cache and network, so it will first check if it's in your cache and return that, but it's always going to do that network query as well. So it gives you an immediate response, and then it will query the network and update it when that comes in. Network only, in case you don't want to check your cache, you know this might have changed somewhere, so I don't want to use my cache. I'm going to always make sure I query my API directly. And then cache only, which is the opposite, queries the cache. Only queries the cache, and you'll get an error if it's not in there. Yes, sir.
So with the cache and network, so it pulls it out of the cache out of the memory, and then it hits the network and it comes back. If it's different, does it do some sort of like a differ function, see if it's different, and then emits another value in the observable stream?
I haven't used cache and network directly. I believe it will. You'll just get a new value changes. But you may need to use like distinct until change to determine if it changed.
Yeah. So you can just, yeah.
But I think you would get another update from the network. I'm not 100% certain on that though.
First comes through the data from memory, and then some time afterward, mm-hmm. the same comes back that network. Got it.
Mm-hmm. Cool. And then you got your three error policies that Apollo uses. The default one being none, where we treat GraphQL errors as runtime errors. And Apollo is going to discard any data that came back with the request, and then you can render your component with that error property. The ignore error policy is very similar to none. It causes Apollo to ignore any data from your server, but it also does not update your UI, so you don't get anything back when you get an error. Normally, you get either a data or an error property, or both, depending on what your policy is. And then all being you want to get the data and the error, and then you can decide what to do once, how to render it once you've examined maybe your error. And as it says, it's particularly helpful if you're doing server-side rendering, and that way your UI is always going to show something at least. So GraphQL mutations are, as you can see, they look very similar to queries. So for example, we want to create a user, and here you can see the use of variables. You can add a name, which is a string, and an email is a string, and then in your input, the create user will just use whatever you passed in, and then you can have it return nothing, you can have it return the fields that were created, or you can have it return what's called a client mutation ID, which is a field that you just give with your mutation, and it'll return it back exactly as you sent it. But again, you can see the response looks exactly like the response that you requested in your mutation itself. Obviously, the ID wouldn't be known until it's created, so that's going to be returned after it creates it. So in your API service, and once again, this is just how I implemented it for this application. There's various other options associated with query and mutate that I haven't included here, but you can check the documentation for those, but same thing, we can get a string, we can get the variables, and then update is an optional feature there. So after the mutation comes back, you can have it do something, generally update your cache in case it wasn't updatable. For the most part, Apollo will update your cache automatically based on IDs, but if it wasn't able to for some reason, maybe you had a query that was named with kind of differently and it wasn't able to figure out where the results are supposed to go, you can add some logic in there and kind of tell it. So as far as an application structure, we've gone over the API module and the API service. We've looked at a few GraphQL queries. Let's go ahead and look at the app. So this is a demo app. So this is a kind of a, if you've done the Angular tutorial, this is a Tour of Heroes version. So let's look at some hero queries that I created. So for example, you can look at grab all heroes, and that's with post graph file. I believe this is a GraphQL standard. When something returns a list, it's going to be inside one of these node objects or nodes object. So you're going to get a list of nodes that are each a hero fragment. And then a hero fragment is going to have a node ID, a hero ID, and a hero name. The node ID that you're seeing here is something specific to PostGraphile, although you could include it in any of your backends. So what Apollo does in terms of caching, it'll normally just use an ID field. So say you have a hero of ID 1, and then you have, since I've got powers in here, you have a power of ID 1. From the cache perspective, it just knows there's two things with an ID of 1, and it's going to cache in the same. So you either have to tell Apollo how to handle that situation. And you do that here when you're creating your in-memory cache. You say your data from ID from object, in this case, is going to be a node ID or null. And what PostGraphile will do is say, I know that this is an object of type heroes, and it's got this ID, and it'll make a base64 encoded version of that string to make sure you've got a unique ID for everything. But you could do the same thing in this function if you just want to keep an ID field. I prefer to use the more descriptive ID fields have actually a hero ID in it. And then say you want to be able to look up a hero and you want more than just the hero, the basic hero details, you also want to know what powers are associated with that hero. You can do hero, you can add hero powers by hero, and that's something that PostGraphile will generate just by knowing that that foreign key relationship exists. And it'll include every power that's associated with that hero as well. And we'll look at that in a little bit more detail in just a minute. So we've covered the queries, the fragments. If you want to look at a mutation.
Yes, sir. Bump the size of the text up. Those are actual strings, right?
They are strings. You import this GQL library, and that will convert this string into the necessary format that it needs to do the query. Let's see. Sorry about that. Yeah. And also notice that when you are including a fragment, you have to put at the end of the query where that fragment comes from. So in here, we're importing the hero power fragments. So we, since we're using that here, along with the hero fragment, we have to note that within the fragment itself. And I just updated the most recent version of WebStorm, and apparently it doesn't like some of these things. So it's not an interface. What this actually is, so this is because I'm not actually running the API yet. Let's start them both. So one nice thing about WebStorm is it has a GraphQL plugin. So once we refresh, now it knows that there's a hero, and it'll know, you know, what it'll do completion for you since it can introspect. Hero is defined in the database. And then, so it's coming from the API. If we look at the, sorry, I can't see that. So if we look at our API, we can see that it did an introspection query when I ran that refresh in the client. And this pulls from the API everything that it knows about. And we can, when we look at graphical in a minute, it'll become even more clear. So next we can look at the application itself. So what we've got here in the database, we've got some heroes. So what we did first is we pulled the top heroes by running this top heroes query. And first is a thing that PostgreSQL will give you to pull just the first five. It's kind of a limit within the database. So in this particular instance, all we want is the name. So that's why we're using just the hero fragment. We don't care about the powers. And later, when we want to look at the powers, we'll run a different query. One other nice thing about the query ref is that allows you to do this refresh. That was one of the methods that we had on it. So when we're declaring our API in here, we've got a hero query, which is a query ref, and a hero observable. So when we initialize, we're going to create this query, and then the observable is off the query. And then we want to refresh our data. For example, if you're in a mobile app, you want to do the pull down to refresh your data thing, you can have that call just a refresh method that runs on the query, and then that data will come back in through the observable. And when you use an async pipe, it'll get updated automatically. So for example, let's say you know in your database one other thing that you do in PostgreSQL, you tend to separate out your data into a specific schema, and that way your API can only touch that schema. Since it does support authentication and authorization, that makes it easier to define what tables it's allowed to access. So if you maybe create a demo private schema, then the API wouldn't be able to access that, but maybe you have another microservice that's like an authentication service that can update that. So we've got our heroes here. Let's just change one of their names. And now when we refresh, Mr. Mean turns into Mr. Nice. You can see the query down here hitting the API. Let's go to the hero details. So here we're looking at Mr. Nice, who has one power of teleportation. We can change his name back to Mr. Mean. And when we do that, I probably should have brought up. So in the network, let's say we change his name to Mr. Joe. That's going to do a mutation here. But then if we go back to our homepage, we didn't have to do another query because we updated our cache. There's actually a plugin for Chrome that'll let you look at your cache. So you can see these are the Base64 encoded IDs, the node IDs that I mentioned. So if we update Mr. Joe back to Mr. Mean, you see our cache gets updated automatically because it sees that node ID. And that's why it doesn't have to re-query when you go back. Heroes also have powers. So as I mentioned before, you can have a stored procedure. So say we want to add a power to this hero. If the power is already in there, we just want to use it. If it's a new one, then we need to create it first. So I added a little function here that checks if the power exists. If it doesn't, then we insert it, and then we use that power to create a hero power, which is just that join table between heroes and powers. So for example, we've got say telepathy. So if I add telepathy here, notice first of all that the cache also gets updated, and we have, and it's using the power ID that was already in there, power ID 7, which was telepathy. And then if we add a new one, say super speed, then it created a new power and added that to, so that wasn't in there before and now it is. So it's functionally similar to REST. You're making queries, you're making updates, you're doing creates, deletes. If I want to delete super speed from him, now it's gone. And but it does have a lot of nice built-in stuff that'll help you when you're updating your application. So if we go back to the hero search or the homepage. I'm using Clarity here. If you're not familiar with it, it's a nice component library created by VMware. So say we want to search for, I forgot what their names were. Dynama. We can do that by putting an observable on this input field. So every time you type in that input field, if you put enough characters in there, what it'll do is go out and do that query. You'll see this value changes. So that's going to get the change. Then we use map to destructure the object that comes back. Let's look at the response real quick. Is this big enough for everyone to see? So this is the all heroes query looking for Dynama. Comes back with that hero. And it looks like just what we asked for. We asked for the ID name and the node ID. And in this particular case, we didn't care about the power, so we didn't have to query for it. And when we destructure the object, we know what it looks like, so we just pull out all of this stuff and go directly to the data itself that we're interested in. And then along similar lines, we could maybe search for all heroes that have a specific power. So say teleportation. We know Mr. Mean has that power. So that's the same type of thing. It just does a different query, which is down here. Runs this all powers query and gets back every hero with that power. The hero search is using that filter plugin. If we look at the query. So when we're searching, we're using this query here, and we're using this filter plugin. So that basically adds an extra attribute that you can add to your queries. And it's using the Postgres operator like in Sensitive. So we're just passing in what they've typed in with some percents around it, so it does a like search within Postgres to return that. And then as we saw in PowerSearch, we did that nested query. Oh, and also the PowerSearch is using the network-only fetch policy. So if, for example, you went in and changed a hero and added a new power, did that query, it's going to still be able to find them without having to update your cache. In case you wanted to do it that way.
Hey Frank, does it do any sort of like cascading update in your cache? So like you add, let's say you change telepathy to foo, is it gonna?
It depends. If you've queried for it in the right way, in the way that it understands, and yes, it'll recognize that the node ID comes back is the same as the other node ID, which is what we did. For the hero, I believe. I don't have a power update. So yeah, if we went and changed the name of a power, I believe it would still know that ID is the same, and that ID is associated in the cache, because that's what it uses.
And then every hero that has that power would get the update?
Right.
Cool. All
right. And we've talked a bit about the caching so far. So I think we pretty much already covered that going through the demo. But again, we'll cache all your data. You do have to let it know what the appropriate ID is in order to update the cache sometimes. But in general, it'll do pretty much handle all of that for you. As far as development tools and resources, so graphical. Is this. So what it'll do is tell you all of your queries, every type, what they return, everything you can ask for, basically. So for the all heroes query, this is that first option that I mentioned earlier. You can do any of these to get a specific thing. The filter is added by that filter plugin, so you have to use that plugin in order to get that functionality. But it's easy, it's just another yarn or npm add. And then it's going to return this hero's connection type. As I said, since it returns a list of objects, it's going to return it in nodes. And then here's what a hero looks like. And then since heroes are associated with powers, you can get the hero powers just by adding this to your query. And then that node ID is going to be in there for pretty much anything. So graphical is a really good tool to help you out when you're developing. It tells you all about your queries, mutations, types. Another thing to notice when you're defining your schema, and this is just applies to PostgreSQL, obviously, because this is a Postgres specific thing, but you can add comments to every table and column, and those will show up here. So note, and one other thing you can do is you can deprecate fields directly in your schema just by adding a comment. So if you'll notice here, a hero has just an ID and a name. You don't see that deprecated field in here until you go down here and you say, oh, secret identity should not be revealed. And you can still query for it, but it'll warn you in GraphQL right here, that the hero field, the field has been deprecated. And there's a few different nice things that PostgreSQL does for you like that. There's another client called GraphQL Playground, which is similar to graphical, but it's just a desktop application. One nice thing that this one will do is let you add in query variables, which PostgreSQL also does, but it lets you add in headers. So if you want to add an authorization, you can do it directly in here. If you're doing it with graphical, you have to download some kind of browser plugin and just add a header that way. As I mentioned, WebStorm has that plugin to let you introspect your UI, your API, and it'll tell you how to code, basically. tell you all the fields you can query for and warn you if you're doing something you shouldn't be doing. VS Code has one as well. The DevTools Chrome extension was what we were looking at that shows you your cache. There's a Slack for support of Apollo, and there's a Gitter for PostgreSQL if you have any questions. They're pretty helpful on there. We're pretty close to end of time right now, so I will skip straight to the summary. Before I do that, so GraphQL versus REST definitely have some differences. The main ones I would point out are, how many of you have been working with a REST API and wondering, should I be using a put or a post or a patch? And if I'm using a patch, what kind of patch should I use? Is this an actual patch or is this a JSON patch? You don't have to worry about any of that with GraphQL. Also, how many of you have been told you're going to be working with RESTful API only to determine, this is just some URLs that return JSON? Not as prevalent these days. A lot of people have actual RESTful API implementations, but I'm not going to say that GraphQL will solve all of your problems, but between front-end and back-end communication, I've only done front-end and back-end by myself, so I haven't worked with a back-end developer who's doing a GraphQL server, but I know when I was doing RESTful API, I would often have to go back to the API developer and say, well, you've got to add this, or you've got to change this, or you change this and you broke my client. So the important thing to note is that REST can be implemented in ways to give it most of the GraphQL advantages. You can have it, like right there. You can provide sparse field sets using JSON API. You can provide types and schemas using Hadios, I think it's pronounced, JSON schema. You can evolve your API instead of using like the slash v1, v2 type things that are bad or not as widely accepted. And there's a not necessarily a spec, but best practices that you can follow to get a lot of the advantages. But GraphQL has all of that already in opinionated convenient solutions. So if your REST API is following those good practices, you may not need GraphQL, you may not want GraphQL, but if you do have a highly queryable API, if you would expect an array of clients that needs small and different data, and you can restructure your data to be inexpensive to query, then GraphQL is likely to fit your needs. And remember, you don't have to choose. You can use both concurrently. You can use different multiple GraphQLs. They have schema stitching, so you can combine them together into one. But